Hello, welcome to Daily Current Affairs by Neo IAS. Today is 15th of December 2018. So the topics we are going to deal is Punganur Cow, Future Earth, Duty Drawback Rate, Jnanapeed Award, then Photo DNA, eFlow Notification, Map Aided Program and Previous Year Question Revision Series. So let's start. The first news is Punganur Cow. So this is basically a cattle breed found in Andhra Pradesh. So I'll tell you why is it in news. This Punganur cow is in Andhra. It is used for various purposes. It is very short and but the thing now happened is it is in the verge of extinction. So this farmers, because of its multi-purpose use, is crossbreeding it. It is a very high extent. It is crossbreeded. So what happened? This thing, this cow is coming to an extinction. So that is a major concern now because it has many functions. It is very efficient cow. So it has been a concern and the people, the farmers and the government, they are taking care of it. How to control this crossbreeding and how to protect these species. So it have a few very special characteristics. One is that it is the very smallest breed of the of cattle in the world. The smallest in the world, because it is very short, its height is very short. We have one more variety called as Ongol cow. It's called as Ongol or Ongol cow. It is also from Andhra Pradesh. Basically, this cow is also very short. This is about 1.5 meter height, but compared to this, Punganur is somewhat lesser than this Ongol cow. It is only 90 centimeter. The maximum height it can go is 90 centimeter. So both these breed are the indigenous categories from Andhra Pradesh. It is they trace the origin from Andhra Pradesh. And also this breed is it's a dwarf category, and it is noticed because of this. It's very healthy one and it is very fat also, but it is short and it doesn't have this very big horn like other cows. It is having very short cone, as you can see in the picture. It has very short horns and a broad forehead it has. And the specialty is it is drought resistant. So a part of Andhra which is very dry area, this species can survive there also. It can be feeded by this dry fodder which is found in a major part of Andhra Pradesh. It can be feeded with this dry fodder also. So it's very drought resistant. And the application level, it is being used in transportation for driving carts, but not very huge transportation, not for like carrying very huge cargoes and all. It's for a lighter weight, and it has been used in races. It feed mills. Then it is also used in agricultural purposes for light soil farming. Okay, not for the big thing, only for light soil farming. So it has major purpose in Andhra geographical terrain. So it has to be protected. Okay, next thing is Future Earth. Future Earth, I'll tell you, this is a global research platform. It's a research purpose thing. But it is in news because the scientists associated with this global research platform called as Future Earth, they have shown a concern regarding the climate change catastrophes which have to be, it is to be going to happen in future. So there is a major concern of this catastrophic issues due to climate change, and the scientists are alerting the government regarding this purpose. So it is a 10-year program. It gives us knowledge and it supports to accelerate the transformation. That is, whatever transformation we are doing in our life with these technologies, they are showing us how to link this thing to a sustainable world, how to make it very sustainable. That is their function. So basically there are three projects happening before Future Earth. That is International Geosphere Biosphere Program, IGBP, and this International Human Dimensions Program, IHDP, and Diversitas. So these programs are already in action, and these three things merged together in 2014 to form this Future Earth. Okay, so they also work in close association with this World Climate Research Program, WCRP. It's a very famous program. It also carry out this research and purposes related to the climate change and whatever things are happening in the environment. So they are concerned with the climate change issues, and the Future Earth Program is working in association with this World Climate Research Program. Okay. And it also attract new researchers. So whatever research is happening in the world right now, various countries, even India has many projects coming up under startups and various other research program regarding how to tackle this climate change. So Future Earth is inviting all such sustainable research programs or inventions, and also the stakeholder communities together to make a better world. Okay, also the project, this project is implemented through the collaboration of Government of Quebec and City of Montreal. Okay, and the earlier I mentioned about International Geosphere Biosphere Program. So this research program, which was before Future Earth, it was active. This program deal with the whatever things, the biological process, that may be the physical, the chemical, the biological process, which regulate the earth system. So whatever processes are regulating the earth system, this system has been studied and researches are made on, upon it. Okay, and there is one more thing I mentioned, the International Human Dimensions Program. It is also basically a research program, and it deals with the global change. Whatever change that is happening in the world right now, they are dealing about it and making research on it. Okay, and the third one was Diversitas. Diversitas is about, we have this biodiversity science, and we have this biodiversity researchers, the papers, the findings happening, and using all these findings and studies for the betterment of human beings is dealt by Diversitas. So there are basically three programs, that is International Geosphere Biosphere Program, International Human Dimensions Program, and this Biodiversity. All these three were transferred or brought under Future Earth. So this is very important regarding climate change. That is clear. Now coming to the duty drawback rate, that's the next next topic we are going to discuss, duty drawback rate. This is a kind of economic news. And there is an organization called as Apparel Export Promotion Council, AEPC. So this council is responsible for making the policies or the schemes related to export and making the formulation regarding exports and the export rules. So recently they have requested the government to review the duty drawback rates. So they have asked the government to review it and make a slight difference to the rate of the ready-made garments. Okay, so what basically the duty drawback rate is, we have exports happening in our country. So in order to export this quality goods of maybe the electronics or the textile industry, whatever it is, let's say textile industry. So we have this textile industry is happening, and we export qualified, very quality articles to other countries. So before happening, before this exporting, we need the raw materials and we are importing it from some other country. So while importing the merchandise, what we are doing, we are paying some duty or tax or fees, and we are importing these things. After importing, we are making it qualified articles and we are exporting it to the international market. So what this government is doing is, government is compensating all these things, whatever the duty or the tax or the fees we have paid, they are compensating it, it has been refunded back to us. So this is actually a good thing. It is an export promotion program. It supports exports. Before, it was like, we have to export things, and but the import duty on the raw material is very high, so we are not getting any much profit out of it. So while getting the refund for the duties which have been paid on the import, it's much more easily profitable, and the export is promoted through this program. So World Trade Organization also has some rules. This program is complying to World Trade Organization rule. Only a very few export incentives are acceptable under WTO actually. But this thing has been acceptable. This is in lines with WTO rules. Okay. Next is Jnanpeeth Award. So Jnanpeeth Award was in news because Amitav Ghosh got Jnanpeeth Award for his book The Great Derangement. But our area of interest is not who got the award or for what book it has got. We are looking into what is Jnanpeeth Award, what is its background. Okay, so this Jnanpeeth Award is the highest literary honoring award for the literature field. And it has been given by this Bharatiya Jnanpeeth. It is an organization which provides awards to the writers in exemplary writers in the field of literature, and it is this organization is constituted in 1961. It's an old organization. Since then, they have been providing awards for literature. So the literature award is given to the languages mentioned in the 8th schedule of the constitution, that is the 22 scheduled languages plus English. All these 23 languages is being given. The award is selected for literature from this 23 languages, and no posthumous conferral is given. So it is a very special award, and the prize money is around 11 lakh and they'll be giving a bronze replica of Saraswati, because Saraswati is regarded as the Hindu goddess of knowledge and wisdom. So they are giving a bronze statue of Saraswati and 11 lakh rupees. So this time Amitav Ghosh got the award. Okay, next is Photo DNA. Photo DNA is a very sensitive program by the Indian government. Actually, they are doing it with collaboration of US government as well. I'll tell you what is Photo DNA. These days, child pornography and the videos of raping children are being circulated a lot in cyber media. So, what happened is that the government has been trying to curb this through various methods. And to an extent, they are trying to make it in a pan India level. So what they are doing right now is they are associating with the US wing of this child pornography restriction, that is the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. This is a organization of the US government dealing with the child crime, whatever is happening. So, the Indian government, the Ministry of Home Affairs and the NCMEC of US is collaborating to create a virtual private network. Virtual private network is anything that is created in the cyber area. It's in the internet. Okay, they're creating it and they're linking all the police station of the India, all the Indian police station to this network. So whenever a crime is reported in any of the police station in pan India level, immediately every police station is getting connected and every police station is getting the news about the crime. So this is a much more higher level project happening in this child abuse. And CCTNS, yes, you already know, the CCTNS is crime and criminal tracking network system that is practiced in India. It is a cyber security network, and this thing, it's a cyber network actually deal with the Indian police to track the crime and the criminals. So the Photo DNA is also associated with this CCTNS. Okay, and so what this Photo DNA, this Photo DNA technology was developed in 2009 by this Microsoft. Microsoft also the Dartmouth College, they both collaborated to find this thing called as Photo DNA. And it is a technology basically to find the photos or the images of the child being exploited, and they remove it from the net, the internet, as soon as they find it. This is not like what you think, like it's a facial recognition software. No, it's not a facial recognition software. What they're doing is, we'll place a similar photo in it, and they will search the entire internet for that similar photo. So if we place a photo of a child being getting abused, what they're doing is they will search the internet, the cloud, for the similar images. And if they find similar images, they'll delete it. And you cannot recreate it back. Okay, that is how it is working. So that is creating signatures of the same images which we uploaded. So we are giving an image. It's called as a hash. Okay, and they are searching for similar images. That is how this photo DNA works. It's a very sensitive thing because child pornography is a major issue right now. Next is eFlow notification. So eFlow notification means a river should have a minimum flow, minimum environmental flow in various locations. So this notification was in news because a Ganga activist was missing these some days before, because there are a lot of river valley projects and hydro projects happening on this Ganga river. And if all this hydroelectric project or the hydro projects are coming again and again, it can affect the e-flow of Ganga. So it can create major issue for Ganga river. So this activist has been creating awareness of this issue and he went missing. So that is why it is in news. So I'll tell you what e-flow is. Environmental flow or e-flow are the acceptable flow regime that is required to maintain a river in the desired environmental state or the predetermined state. So whichever state the river should be healthy, in order to maintain that healthiness of that river, we have to maintain a required number of water in the river. That is the e-flow. Okay, so it's the least amount of water needed to make the river healthy. Okay, even after all the diversions from the project. So many projects will be there on River Ganga or whichever the river there is. So many diversions will be there, reservoirs will be there. After all this, still the river should maintain a minimum amount of water. That is its e-flow. Okay, so the Central Water Commission is the implementing agency or the designated authority or the custodian of all this data which is related to the regime of the river, and also it's responsible for the supervision, the monitoring and regulation of this flows. Okay, and what is this natural flow regime? Is that the natural flow of a river is it's a pattern, it's a characteristic pattern of that river. So it tells you about the quantity of water in it in each time and the variability happening to the river flow. Everything that happens due to the river size, the variation in the climate, the geology, the topography, the vegetation around, everything determines the flow of the water in the river. So whatever is the flow at various period of time and what is the variation happening to the river flow is its natural flow regime. So whatever the regime is, all the data handling about the regime is handled by Central Water Commission. Okay. Next is a map-aided program. In map-aided program, we have Hodeidah. Hodeidah is actually a port city in Yemen. And it was in news because 53 Houthi rebels of Yemen, they have been killed in Hodeidah. Hodeidah, as in Yemen, it is called as Al-Hodeidah. And we call it Hodeidah. The entire world calls it Hodeidah. And it is the fourth largest city of Yemen, and it's a principal port on Red Sea. I'll show you. This is a map of Yemen, and we have Saudi Arabia to the top and Oman to the east. We can see to the west of Yemen, it is Red Sea, and Red Sea to the easternmost side of Red Sea, we see Hodeidah. We also have Arabian Sea to the lower part of Yemen. Okay, this is how the map is, and we have to know if we locate a place in a country which is in news, also please study the neighboring countries which all water bodies are coming adjacent to it also. Okay, whether it is landlocked, whether it has a seashore, and if so, what all seas are covered by it. These are the things you have to keep in mind while studying about the countries or the places in news. Okay, so that is Hodayida. Coming to the last session, that's the previous revision, year question revision series, we have a question about international agreements. So I'll read out the statements. International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture, United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification, the World Heritage Convention. Which of these above are related to biodiversity? So we'll iterate one by one. What is International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture? So, you must have heard about Rio Summit of 1991. So, in Rio Summit, three major conventions has been signed. That is the United Nations Convention on Climate Change, then UNCCD, that is Compact Desertification, and one is about UNCBD, that is on biodiversity. In biodiversity, there is three major protocols being taken. That is, one is Nagoya, one is Cartagena, and then the third one is International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources. So it deals with biodiversity because it was taken under the Convention on Biodiversity, UNCBD. So first one is true. The next one is United Nations Convention to Combat Desertification, or UNCCD. UNCCD is basically dealing with compacting desertification. Means what? It is trying to control the land getting desertified. It is controlling the land getting desertified, means it is trying to protect the biodiversity. So the second statement was also correct. The third statement is World Heritage Convention, obviously, because India has 35 sites and the sixth one is dealing with biodiversity sites. So obviously, definitely it will be dealing with biodiversity. So all the three statements are correct. Okay, so these are the important news I found in newspaper today. And I found, I think this is useful for you. So if you have any doubts, you can ask me in the comment section. So that's all for today. Thank you guys. Thank you so much.